I don't want to talk about information as much as I want to talk about calculations. And that's going to be one of the takeaways of my speech today, that it's not really about data or information, it's much more about calculations and speed. Now, before I do that, I want to make sure that everybody knows why every now and again there is a stronger French influence to what we're doing. Quintic has been acquired a little over a month ago by Dassault Systèmes from Paris, and we're very excited about it. And the reason we're excited about it is that for the last 17 years, we've been on a journey to be the absolute number one in solving the world's planning puzzles. And we're getting there. We're getting there. We are the number one planning platform that is used by many different organizations. And when you network today, you will see that there's rail companies, there's production companies, there's universities, there's people who move stuff, there is from all walks of life, there are people who all share the same challenge, and that is, how do you solve your puzzle better? And with the endorsement of an extremely long-term focused scientific company that said, we just want to add you to our portfolio and then you can keep doing whatever you're doing because we really like what you're doing, we are now in a stronger position to continue our journey to that number one position. So with that said, let's go to what I like to talk about, and that is big calculations. The idea about big calculations is that you all share a challenge. And it is that you typically need to combine the optimization of at least two conflicting variables. If you're in a production company, on the one hand, you want to deliver everything on time to your customers as fast as possible, but you also don't want to have any setups and you don't want to have any inventory if you can avoid it. So how do you balance those things? If you are in a company that is in logistics, you need to be at the right place at the right time for all your customer demands, but you want to make sure that you're not driving empty miles or you're not going back empty, and that's a challenge. And if you're in workforce planning, on the one hand, you want to service your customers at the right time all the time, but then there are union rules and there's people who have preferences and all of that, and how do you match all those goals together? And with that complexity, once you finally felt that you had things under control, then what happens is that the world tells you to speed up. You have to go faster. You don't deliver tomorrow, you want to deliver today. You can't have customer demand that comes in on a weekly basis. Now you need to change things as they're happening. And Guy Kawasaki, he is known as the guy that gave us the Macintosh, a serial entrepreneur. He mentioned that speed is so important that really it doesn't matter so much which direction you're going as long as you're going fast enough. And I think that in the world that we live in, that's what we're seeing all the time. Things need to speed up. If you look at delivery, I just like this picture. I don't think the drones are really going anywhere in terms of express companies, but it's a cool way to talk about it. But same day delivery, I think, is going to be the absolute big thing. I do believe that the moment I can sit just at home at 2 p.m. and think, hey, what will I have for dinner tonight? Let's go to my Walmart app and, oh yeah, I like that. I had that a week ago. And you click, 5:30 would be fine. And then at 5:30, I get a text message that says, 6 minutes, we will be there. And I can just take it on. And I don't have to go to the local Walmart anymore. And if you say, well, I should have said Amazon, well, that's the two who are going to have a fight about this whole concept. And it's all about speeding up. But when you speed up, things get more complicated, and we'll talk about that. If you look at Richard Branson, he talks about flying from New York to Tokyo in an hour. Now, I do a lot of international travel. I will fly at the end of this week to Brisbane, and then to Melbourne, and then to Sydney, and then back, and then to Paris, and then back, etc. So I would love this to be faster, and although we cannot envision that it will go that fast, fast forward 10 years, 20 years, and then suddenly there are these possibilities. And then finally, if you look at really, really fast, I'm not sure if you've read this book. I read this book. It's called Flash Boys from Michael Lewis, and it's about how having 6 milliseconds of advantage in knowing trades, people made hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars. And did you know that they spent hundreds of millions of dollars to put a fiber line between Chicago and New York? And they tried to make it as straight as possible So they got the 6 milliseconds, they spent hundreds of millions of dollars, and they made billions of dollars doing it. And that's because a small advantage in knowing what is going to happen is actually on the stock markets worth a lot of money. So the summary is that no matter how fast you're going, get prepared to go faster, because that's needed. And if you go faster, your world becomes more complex. And suddenly, old methods may no longer work. If you're in logistics and you used to get all your orders in the day before, and then you had a planner trying to sequence that, and then everybody went to sleep, and then you executed on that, if suddenly the order's coming in right now, you need to respond to it right now, then some of those methods no longer work. So the question now is, with that challenge coming at us, what do we do about it? Well, the answer to every question today is big data. At least I hope that you noticed that that is the word today, big data. That's the solution. But is it really? Clearly, big data is here. If you look at the speed with which data is entering our society and how much we're storing, then I lost track of how to call things. When I started my career in computers, which was when I bought my first Commodore 64 in 1982, it had an amazing 16 kilobyte of memory. And then I expanded it to 64 kilobytes of memory. My laptop that is sitting there right now has 128,000 times as much internal memory as my first computer then. So that is an exponential growth. And right now, look at the numbers. Data that is collected about what happens in the world is still speeding up with Moore's Law. And Moore's Law that was devised in the 1960s by Gordon Moore, one of, I think, the founders of Intel, and it is that the number of transistors on chips would double every approximately, and that's where, you know, it goes a little bit fuzzy, anywhere between 12 and 24 months. And that's still going on, so that has for many, many years kept the pace. And right now with data, that's happening. So there's more and more data. And now the question is, well, what does that mean for us? So you have all the data, so what? What do you do with it? And this is where I think we need to think about big calculations. The idea of big calculations is that what you want to do is you want to optimize your business in real time, which is very short time frames, and you want to be able to give fast results and efficient results. And that's where the question is, how can I make sure that I respond really fast, but also efficiently? And yesterday I was at a dinner with some of our guests here today, and one of the questions that came up is, how do you handle dynamics? Because we have a plan, and then, you know, things happen. And then suddenly we need to scramble. And what is very easy is to get into a situation where you respond to one of the KPIs, oh, this customer needs to be served and we'll get it to him, but then forget about the other KPIs, how to do it efficiently, how to keep our costs down. And the problem is that if you want to do things in real time, your puzzle has just become much more complex. And big calculations is the answer saying, well, let's optimize your business for you so that you can be fast, but you can also be efficient. Now, let's put that on a little bit of a complex slide that I will talk you through to put the spectrum of, on the one hand, big data here, all the way to big calculations. And then we go from data through information to knowledge to decision support and finally to optimization, automated optimization. Now, if you look at data, then typically data is not really, you know, time sensitive. It's data that you collected. If I had been smart, when this morning I drove from Radnor to Philadelphia, where I was late for my first appointment, and I could, of course, claim, well, yeah, there was a traffic accident. If I had used data, then everybody would say, yeah, there's always a traffic accident on 76 in the morning. So you can collect data that you have far in advance that tells you things about the world. It's not really something that I needed real time. Of course, it also helped that I listened to the radio and said, yeah, there's a traffic accident on the 76 and you will be delayed. But data is something that's kind of timeless. And then when you move on in these big calculations, you get much more closer to real time, to now, to immediately. What you can do with, for instance, collecting data about traffic speeds at different roads or distances that people drive or paths that people take, you can use that to then here make sure that you know what maybe the best route could be. And you can use that to make decisions like maybe you get up earlier, because that would get you on time somewhere. And you can make routes. But if you go all the way to the end, in this case to Google Car, great concept, has driven over 100,000 miles, not a single accident. Anyone in the room who has done 100,000 miles without any accidents? Okay, good. Well, so that's pretty good already. And 100,000 miles without any accident. And to do that, and if you look at this dashboard here of the way Google Car looks at the world while it's driving, you can imagine, well, that has to be real time. That is constantly optimizing for what's the speed of that object, what's happening over here, and then responding into it real time. So it's an example of where you move from just having data and then maybe using a GPS system all the way to the promise of, but if you do it right, you can actually in real time drive around the world without a driver, and that creates a lot of efficiency, a lot of drivers that we're not going to need, a lot of time we can spend reading books or doing other things. So in the big calculations, time spectrum, on the one hand, you have big data, kind of timeless, a lot of information, but what you do with it is something that you can do in real time. Now, this also happens in your business. If you look at your business, and let me split the world in three main areas: optimization of, say, manufacturing, optimization of logistics, and optimization of workforce. Then on the one hand, if you look at, say, workforce, you have certain data that you collect and certain rules that you may have regarding how long can someone work, and if you do it at this time, how much do we need to pay them? That's more static and more data oriented, all the way to the place where you do real-time workforce planning, where tasks, when they happen, are allocated to people based on their skills, based on their location, based on anything that is relevant for executing that task at the right time. And if you do that correctly, then you can get a better service to your customers, and you can still make sure that you stay within the rules that you have. If you look at logistics, we have examples where we have customers, and they talk about their puzzles, and they say, well, you know, our world is changing so fast that really planning a day ahead is kind of impossible. I think the most dynamic system that we have done is for a container terminal in Spain. And I'm not sure if you've been in a container terminal. There's a big ship coming in with a lot of containers, and you want to unload those containers. And there's lots of things going on. There's people who are, you know, hooking containers up that need to be taken off by the crane and then put on a little truck and then driven to an RTG that puts it on another stack. And there's question of in what sequence do you take the containers off, and which truck is now available, and which RTG just got a flat tire and as a result, you know, is out of service for a little bit. And that is so dynamic that they say, well, we've never been able to make a plan that lasts for more than an hour and a half because, you know, things are changing. So what they ended up doing is they were just assigning containers the moment they came available. So, oh, go there and go there. And what we now do is we actually make a plan for 90 minutes, and we revise the plan every minute. So what happens is for 30 seconds, we calculate on a 90-minute plan. Then for 30 seconds, we let reality unfold, and then we make a new plan for 30 seconds. And by looking ahead and taking into account what just happened, they actually became 15% more efficient. Because it's the little things of knowing, oh, this container needs to go there, and this RTG is available here. And just looking ahead 90 minutes and revising that in real time all the time turned out to be very useful. Now, what you see in a little bit different time scale is that more and more transport companies do that. In the past, maybe driver got in and he had his trip for the whole day. More and more, they know where they're going now. And when they almost get there, then they get to hear, okay, now you go there. And we'll take care of that you don't drive more than, you know, 11 hours and not more than 14 hours on the road, and that you get to take your breaks and that you're allowed in the different stops. But by giving people just-in-time information, you can still change their plan while they are executing. And then similar, if you look at manufacturing, where maybe in the past people were doing sales and operations planning on a monthly basis, but then, you know, I've seen some of our customers doing their sales operation planning for May, and then they finished that by the 20th of May, which was kind of more, you know, like a preliminary financial reporting. The question is now, can you do that in way more real-time fashion? And everybody's already revising it every week, but would you be able to take all the information of what happens in your supply chain and make sure that your forward look is much more based on what really is happening in supply chain instead of just what you know, based on all data? And so what we are seeing, and what we're seeing in the market, and we're seeing the questions of our customers, we see that people are moving more and more here, and they realize that to be able to handle that, they need more big calculations. They need more of, let's not do it just by hand. And if you look at the tools that you need, it is logical that they come to supply chain planning and optimization, because there is kind of a gap here where if you get to the point that you want to do real-time optimization, you suddenly cannot rely solely on people, because that's not going fast enough. There's this daily, well, we come on the job and we do our planning cycle and then we go and execute it and we come back tomorrow. There's an element of human behavior that has to do with that. But if you want to be really fast, now you suddenly really need to optimize. And when you start doing optimization, it actually, you realize it's really difficult, because there are at least four different things that are going to make your life difficult. So let me talk about number one. It's the butterfly effect. A butterfly effect comes from chaos theory, and that says if a butterfly flaps its wings in China, then that may lead to a tornado or whatever in the US 3 weeks from now. It is the idea that if you take any system and you take very, very small variations in the initial state and then you progress forward, then you get vastly different outcomes. And that applies to the weather, but in many cases it also applies to your planning. If you're, for instance, in rail, we have in the Netherlands, at least, we have a central station called Utrecht Central Station. And it is kind of the center of the Netherlands. And every train in the Netherlands basically goes to Utrecht. And it means that if we have a little disruption in Utrecht, then, you know, everything goes wrong. And where did that disruption originate? Well, somewhere else where someone got a little bit delayed, and then they get to Utrecht, and then everything, you know, goes wrong. So butterfly effect. And I think in your organizations, you have that too. There are lots of examples that you can think of where this small disruption then suddenly becomes a big disruption. For instance, we have a customer in liquid bulk deliveries. And the interesting thing with liquid bulk deliveries is that you go to hospitals and you deliver them oxygen. And have a big tank standing there, and they take oxygen from that for operating theaters and keeping people alive. And the job of the liquid bulk company is to make sure that the tank doesn't get empty. On the other hand, they don't want to go there, you know, all the time to just top it off with a little bit. They want to wait until they can put a full trailer in there. Now, the problem is something called time-varying demand. You come 2 hours later, now you can deliver more. You come 2 hours early, you can deliver less. So the moment something changes that makes that you have less here, now the next customer gets less, and you need to go to someone else, and it propagates through the whole plan. Typically, when you want to make a change to the plan, you make a change to every single driver in the system. So that's a butterfly effect. It's one problem. Second problem is the Mike Tyson problem. And Mike Tyson famously said, everyone has a plan until they get punched or bitten. And and that's what happens when you're suddenly a train breaks down on a track. Okay, now you're in real trouble. Or one of your main machine centers in the production organization breaks down and you need 4 hours of maintenance. Your whole plan immediately is in trouble. And that also happens in every workforce planning. Some people call in sick. Let's not talk about France and strikes, but you know, anything that suddenly disrupts your whole business. That's another thing that happens, major disruptions. Then there's the Buzz Lightyear effect, and to infinity and beyond. Well, almost all the problems that we are trying to solve have a complexity that is mind-blowing in the number of combinations. And for instance, in logistics, if you just take, say, 6 trucks and 50 deliveries, if you're a logistics company and you have less than 6 trucks and less than 50 deliveries today, you shouldn't be here today, because that's, you know, that's not big enough. But the number of possibilities to actually make routes is more than there are atoms in planet Earth. So if you look at the mind-boggling complexity of calculations for most of your organizations, is that you can't just simply go through, okay, let's try every optimization possibility and then pick the best one. So the problem is there are too many possibilities. And when your human planners try to figure out what to do. They somehow use all their experience and gut feel and everything else to come to a solution that just is the best approximation of what they can come up with. And what we have found is that it's typically pretty good, and it's never ever close to optimal. So what we have done is we have made sure that if you look at the steps to get to a big calculation solution, is we've made sure that we get kind of a process to put these various complexities in a model so that you can actually, in practice, get to an optimized solution. And what is important is if you want to make sure that you handle big disruptions, if you handle the small effects of the butterfly effect, if you are looking at all the infinite possibilities that you need to go through, it is important to be structured in your approach. And that is, figure out what is it actually that you're trying to achieve. Are you trying to achieve same-day delivery? Are you trying to achieve a higher delivery performance? Are you trying to make sure that your employees are doing their work within all the rules? So whatever your strategic goal is, then figure out what the actual planning decisions are. What is it that you can choose? To assign someone to a task, to drive a truck somewhere, to make a certain production sequence. And then you model your supply chain, and you always model the supply chain in the context of the goals that you have. And then you start measuring what we call planning KPIs. And the idea of planning KPIs is they measure your future performance. It's never about your past performance. If you want to go your past performance, you should go to your ERP system. You can see what happened, not what you can still do about it. When you look at planning KPIs, you can see what is our performance going to be if we execute the plan that we have just made. If you look at that container terminal, we constantly know what the expected performance for the next 90 minutes is. It's not a guarantee that it will happen because there will be disruptions, but what you will see is what is likely going to happen, and you can still respond to that. And then, of course, you use optimization to ensure that you are there. So big calculations, active optimizing your business in real time to achieve fast and efficient results. Now, let's look at some practical examples of what that means and then see how that relates to what it means for you. This is the first customer we had in the Netherlands many, many years ago in 2000. And what they do is they have an organization that unloads large ships with coal and ore that needs to be transported through the Netherlands to Germany, because that's where people make a lot of stuff in Europe. And the unloading of ships is a very complex task. And the reason it's complex is you cannot just start at the front of a ship and then enter the back of a ship, because if you do that, then after a while you have two half ships because of pressures. That actually once happened, but there was a very small barge that was incorrectly loaded. But when you unload that, then you have different parcels that need to go to different places on site, or they need to go into the silos, or they need to go onto trains. So it's a very complex play, and then you do that with a number of cranes, but they're all on the same rails, so you cannot, for instance, have one crane jump the other to go to the ship that is over here. And what we found is that there is a lot of disruption in this process. If there's too much wind, you can't really operate well. Ships are going to be diverted at last minute. And actually, the moment they had a system that allowed them to plan in real time, instead of on the old, they had drawing papers on which they drew ships manually with guesses of how long things would take. But when they started doing that in real time, I witnessed the following exchange between a planner and a potential customer. The key KPI, by the way, is demurrage. Demurrage is the amount of money you pay if you're late with unloading a ship. And that's $25,000 a day or something like that. That's big money. Now, Rotterdam, just to give you a little bit of geography of Europe, Rotterdam, big harbor, near harbor, Antwerp in Belgium and Hamburg in Germany. And they're kind of competing harbors. So at some states, AMO, this is what the organization calls, full, and they get a call from a ship that is on its way to Hamburg, but they know they're going to be waiting there for a bit. So they give a call to Rotterdam and say, well, can we come there? And so he types in quickly, name of the ship, amount of cargo, drags it into the planning, and immediately he sees that the demurrage, the total demurrage for the next 2 weeks will go up by $30,000. And says, oh yeah, we can have you, it's $40,000. And they made the deal. Knowing exactly what the effects are of any disruption to your plan is very valuable. Before, they had no idea. So if you look at modeling that world, so if you model the supply chain, you need to look at all those components, you need to take all of that into account. Because calculating that $30,000 demurrage change means really knowing how long it takes to unload the ship, knowing that you can put it on site, knowing how all the conveyor belts are configured and how everything connects together, and not just having some sort of a rough estimate. So this is the process you go through. If you look at this nice animal, some of our customers look at it like this. And they say, well, there are certain primals, and you can cut them in different ways. And so one of our customers has as a challenge that they get what they get call head in their factories, and then they decompose them into boxes of meat that are sold on the market. And one of the questions that they have is, if someone calls me now and he wants to have 50 boxes of bone-in filet, can we deliver that? Well, that depends. Depends on the head that's coming in, depends on the production speed that we have on the line. The production speed depends on whether it's bone-in or bone-out, because if it's bone-out, the production speed goes lower. Now, if you cut the primal in one way, then you have back ribs. If you cut it another way, well, you don't have back ribs as a side product. So depending on all sorts of decisions, this cow translates in different products that they can sell. So now, do I really know what can happen? Well, so our system for this organization actually serves that. So they're on the phone, they ask question of this product, and then in real time, it does calculate whether you can use some of the production facilities in the coming days to that deadline to cut in a different way to still service all the orders of all customers. It's doing that in real time. So that's kind of the disruption that you have. Suddenly customer threatens with order, should we take it? Now, what is the butterfly effect here? Well, head that come in have a certain expected status, but they're only really validated when they get into the factory. And then it turns out it was prime or USDA, I don't know all the different types, but it turns out to be a different type, and that immediately ripples through the whole chain, and that means that now this needs to be produced over here, and then something else needs to be produced in another factory. And so there's this constant re-optimization. So what we do is we do real-time optimization to do quotes, and we do a nightly re-optimization for the next 14 days for everything that has already been promised. And the goal is to make sure that you keep all your promises to your current customers. Again, same process. Here we have a factory. It's a representation of a process industry situation. And one of the customers we work for, they found that because everything flows through pipes and tanks, is that the moment one process delays, it ties up part of the supply chain, and now other processes cannot happen. And what you look in their Gantt chart, if you look at their plan, then the little delays in one, just like, you know, Utrecht station having a delay, immediately leads to a delay throughout the whole schedule, and all sorts of resources are underutilized because processes don't keep flowing. And they found out that the sum of the disruptions is such that if they don't re-optimize their complete schedule every 4 hours, then they just have a lot of waste. So they have an optimization that is not human intervention at all. They can if they want to, but it is constant re-optimization to optimize the factory. And the result is a much better utilization of their resources. We've talked about trucks. I'm not sure whether this picture completely indicate how we decompose trucks, because it's not about that. It is about all the routes you have and all the responses that you need to have to immediate needs. So one of our customers in the US is Walmart, and Walmart has 7,000 trucks driving around in their private fleet. And what's happening, they're constantly redirecting those trucks based on vendor loads coming available, stores needing an extra load to be delivered, taking into account all the constraints of their DCs, their locations, and of course with a goal to reduce the total empty miles. And so what happens there is there's not a daily plan, there's a continuous plan that's continually tweaked based on all the information that happens in the supply chain. And then finally, this also works for production, where if you look at a hot mill factory in aluminum, where they take a big slab like this, and in about 5 to 6 minutes, it's by going back and forth through the breakdown mill, and then finally through the finishing mill, it becomes a nice coil that has the right physical properties. The challenge here is that you have typically 23 furnaces or so feeding one hot mill, and the hot mill is a temperature sensitive process, and so they typically break down every now and again. And temperature changes then make that you need to start on certain products. But those 23 furnaces that have been going for hours and hours, they come available and you can't really do something about it. So how do you respond to a relatively unstable process on a hot mill with a feeding process that just keeps going and can't really be stopped? Again, you need to respond fast to such changes. So, in summary, what we are seeing all around the world in all sorts of planning puzzles is that the effects that we just showed, the Buzz Lightyear effect, Mike Tyson effect, the butterfly effect, these are all things that are happening in those supply chains every day. What we're also seeing is that everybody needs to speed up, and that because you need to speed up, you need to respond to those disruptions faster, because otherwise you're going to be much less efficient. And that is where we think the world will move more and more on the spectrum from big data to big calculations, where you need to support your supply chains with systems, not just people, but systems that help you make decisions in real time. And that's what big calculation is about.